My guest today is Sarah Gillings. She's an inclusive artist, she's a political artist, she's a feminist artist. She's even had a thank you note, especially from the Prime Minister Theresa May, thanking her for her work of art. So, thank you for coming today.
And we'll talk
about that letter from Prime Minister in a minute. But before we start talking about you and your art and your career, you actually believe that art can make a real change, don't you?
Yes.
Politically, socially, community-wise?
Yes, I do. I think it sort of touches places that other places can't reach, actually, in
us. Okay. So, in terms of touching places that others can't reach, tell me a little bit about what you actually do and what is an inclusive artist? What do you include?
Yes, well, as it sort of suggests, including anybody, but especially marginalised members of society. So it could be young people that are completely disengaged, could be homeless people, anyone needing some kind of artistic intervention because it's therapeutic.
Right. And a lot of people do that. I mean, there are plenty of artists who run workshops in a sort of therapeutic kind of way, etc. But I think you do it in a slightly different way, or you've taken it to perhaps slightly different places.
Yes.
Especially with your street art.
Yeah.
You're quite unusual, A, in that you're a woman in a non-female field, really, and in terms of you having kind of done something recognised in something that is not quite legal sometimes.
Yeah.
So let's hear about your street art involvement first.
Well, you're right. It is a sort of subversive thing, which is why it was really nice to get the award from Number 10 Downing Street, because basically if this government sort of like what I'm doing, then I'm onto something good.
Right.
So I've taken it in lots of different directions. And personally, the art that I like doing as an artist myself is art that supports women and girls' rights.
Right. And talking about women and girls' rights, there's a particular field that you've been very involved in, and that's female genital mutilation.
Yeah.
Tell me a little bit about that and your involvement.
Well, I've only really been doing spray painting myself for about 4 or 5 years, and it's been a really powerful medium. And I got involved with an all-female takeover of the Banksy Tunnel about 4 years ago. And it was in association with a charity called Plan UK. And what they do is they do a lot of work against forced child marriage and FGM.
In this country or around the world?
All over the world. But in this particular country, that's what they're doing. And, you know, it's quite horrific, the figures of the amount of girls at risk in the UK. And when I created my piece of art, I wanted to do something. We weren't actually allowed to do anything too explicit and too shocking, which lots of artists may want to do, because it was obviously in a public setting. So what I decided to do was to pick a well-known Disney character.
And that's Alice in Wonderland, which we will be showing on the screen.
Yeah, so, and what she epitomises is the idea of Britishness, you know, the blonde, blue-eyed girl. And I wanted to make it quite hard-hitting, so she's pulling back a curtain, and obviously, as you can see, there's a print. And it's a play on in the film or in the books, painting the roses red. And you've got all these beautiful white roses that are actually bleeding.
And scissors.
And scissors. I included scissors as well. So you've got the idea of cutting and bleeding, and obviously the rose to signify the female genitalia. And above that, I actually put a huge banner with the statistics of 64,000 girls at risk per year.
64,000.
Yeah, and that's not a worldwide figure, that's UK.
That is incredible, that is shocking.
Yeah.
I had no idea until I read about it.
Yeah.
What kind of reactions have you had to this piece?
Yeah, I mean, particularly quite often men were really shocked. You know, first of all, I'd just written FGM, so I hadn't kind of explained that means female genital mutilation. So as I was painting and doing that piece of street art, you know, there were 10,000 visitors that day to the tunnel, by the way. So that's 10,000 people that see this. And lots of guys came up to me saying, wow, what is this? What does FGM mean? And when I explained what it was, they were horrified.
Right.
Absolutely horrified.
Right.
Yeah.
What I find interesting is that you chose Alice in Wonderland and whatever you did with it, but your background is actually you worked as a designer for Disney.
Yes, I designed a lot of consumer product in my time. I am guilty of doing that, yes.
And so from really designing goods with Disney figures on, you've decided to take this image and really turn it into a completely different thing. Is that something that you... was that a process of thinking?
Definitely. I mean, it took me a long time to come up with that idea of, you know, the Alice. And it was very powerful. Because it's been repainted on numerous occasions. And again, you can see from some of the images projected in the background, it's actually been painted also in Vienna. And normally these things are painted over, but actually this Alice, she remains.
She has survived.
And she's been rather tattooed. She's got a few tags and tattoos on her, but the message is fundamentally still there, yeah. So
right.
That's really good. It's sort of hard-hitting.
And so women's rights in general is something that you're very passionate about, yes? Do you want to give me some other examples of work that you've done that's related to the whole subject?
Yes. Well, some of the current work that I'm doing is going to be launched on International Women's Day this year. And I'm doing a triptych at the Chapter 13, which is a tattoo and art gallery.
Right.
And they have kindly... I put out a call on Facebook saying I'm interested in having walls in Brighton to show female empowerment messages. And surprisingly, I had really lots of businesses coming up to me and saying, you can have our wall. So this is one of the walls that I'll be doing, and it's a triptych. So I'm doing a little play on the Liberté, Égalité, Fraternité. And I'm doing my own version of that. And the middle panel is the one that's going up on International Women's Day, which is about equality. And I have translated that into equal work deserves equal pay.
Right.
And I've used my daughter as my muse. So she's modelled for me. And she's a young girl, and I want her to grow up in a world where she actually gets the same pay for the same work and can expect that.
And another female figure that's become an iconic figure in the, you know, movement for feminism and equal rights, etc., is Frida Kahlo.
Absolutely.
And you've used her. Tell me about that.
Yeah, I've used her on two occasions. On one occasion, it's in a very public setting, and that's down at the seafront on Madeira Drive. And I have subverted the We Can Do It poster from the war, the propaganda poster to get women to come and work in the munitions factories. And I've put Frida Kahlo's head on her. And she's tattooed. And the message is love yourself, empowerment, because Frida Kahlo was her own muse.
She was. What kind of reactions do you get to that?
It's amazing. I mean, there's some YouTubers that are quite famous, that have millions of followers. They've taken photos of it. It gets spread virally, you know, all over the world, which is lovely to see people tagging me in it. And they seem to love it.
I mean, you seem to be, in a way, a member of a group, not willingly a member of a group, but there are Guerrilla Girls in America, which is a group of feminist artists.
Yes.
In Russia. There are various groups of artists who obviously protest against various things, politically, etc. But you're essentially an artist, and I've seen some of your work, and a lot of it is very beautiful, ecological, flowers. Don't you get sometimes perhaps a little bit tired of fighting a cause, fighting for, you know, social justice? Do you sometimes feel torn between perhaps the will to create beautiful art for the sake of art rather than fighting wars, or not?
I do a bit of both, because obviously, as well as my campaigning work, I have to pay my bills. So right. I do commission work, and there's various commissions that I've done, and obviously that supports me to do the work that I really love as an artist. So. Right.
Is there any particular work that you feel stronger than others, or about something that you like or something you're particularly proud of, or do you feel as attached to all your work?
I think it's an ongoing journey. I think all the works that I'm in the process of producing now are the ones I'm falling in love with, and that's kind of how it works as an artist. I think you've done it and you've got that idea out, and then it's really nice to actually move on to the next thing. So the new things that I'm doing are going to be completely new. They're not going to be spray paint.
Before you're telling me about the new things, okay. We're going to take a little break.
Okay.
Join us after the break. With me, Sarah Gillings, an inclusive artist. And just before the break, we were talking about the fact that it's an ongoing process, things that you have been involved with, things that you're looking forward to. What are you looking forward to doing more in the future?
I'm looking forward to developing the charity that I founded two years ago.
So the charity that you founded is a charity that works with young people, is that right?
That's right.
Called You Can Spray.
That's right.
Tell me a little bit about that charity.
Yes. Well, first of all, charities and social enterprises are often created to resolve a problem that we have in society. And one of the problems that I've noticed is that there's a growing number of NEETs, which is an acronym. I don't really like acronyms because we're dealing with people, but it's an acronym for young people who are 16 to 24 is their profile. And NEET means not in employment, education or training. And there's a growing number of these types of young people across the UK. And as we know, due to austerity cuts, there's a lot of underprivileged young people around and actual poverty.
And so what does a charity do to get some help for these young people?
Yeah, well, basically, there's clear links, and there's been studies, the link between poverty and lack of culture. So the idea of the charity is to create cultural experiences for young people, but not just trying to do sort of stuffy cultural experiences, something that they're really interested in. And of course, young people are really interested in street art, so it's a street art charity.
And so you run workshops, and young people are actually allowed to create graffiti, street art.
Exactly.
And that relates to the letter that you got from the Prime Minister. So you were awarded a special award, weren't you?
Yes, I was. And I was so happy to get that because, you know, myself, I've put in thousands of hours into developing this charity. So it's a double whammy, really, because it's recognising the work that I've done, but it's also, more importantly, you know, recognising the charity, which is going to open doors for us, and it has already. We've already received £5,000 funding from a local trust in Lewes to get us an administrator. So having this Points of Light award is actually going to really help the charity grow. Yeah.
And I read in your blog after you received the award that it's quite ironic in a way, well, quite funny and ironic. Ironic in the sense that there's so many government cuts in the creative arts field, and yet it's the very same government that gives you the money. And funny because graffiti is obviously something that's not looked at favourably, and yet this government has endorsed your work.
That's right. I've got the little seal for number 10 Downing Street, which is really, really nice. I like the sort of irony of that. That really works for me, yeah.
I also read in your blog that you said, oh, I'm so pleased that nobody's asked me about, you know, me perhaps encouraging young people to to be vandals.
Yes.
Nobody's actually said that to you when you presented your case and when you got your award. But I'm going to ask you about that. Yes. So you're working with disengaged young people.
Yeah.
You know, young people who are not in education, not in training, young people with difficulties and issues. And you know, you come to these communities with brushes and cans and. Okay, this is a structured activity. Is there no risk that you're actually going to encourage antisocial behaviour as a result?
Yeah, that's a good question. I make it a real point that they don't want to get in trouble and have a criminal record, because unless we're doing this as a legal activity, you know, if they just decide to go and put their skills that they've learnt onto private walls, they're going to get in trouble. So I make that really clear.
And they listen.
They do listen. And we also work out ways for them to actually create street art not reliant on a wall. So they can create it on a T-shirt. They can create it on an old piece of vinyl record. Or they can do it on a canvas.
Okay.
So they can actually make things as gifts. For other people.
Okay.
Yeah.
So as a rule, you believe that art reaches places that other forms don't, and art can actually make a change. You are quite particular, and I found that interesting, that beyond the art, you said it's very important to go and look at the policies, you know, look at the politics of things and plan accordingly.
Yes.
How do you gauge your success? I mean, yes, I know you have had so many likes and so many comments from people, and it is an impressive achievement, but how, I mean, is there any way of actually gauging your success?
Yeah, there's various different measures that you can take, like there's different ways of measuring success, like the theory of change, evaluations, and all of this type of thing. And we're very, very careful as a charity to make sure that we're not only just getting feedback, we're following and working with people on the longer term. So the big plans for the charity are to be able to give arts awards and accreditations so that young people can actually begin to get positive tools to help them back into employment. So it's a long-term process. It's not a sort of just a one-term fix, although it can be very empowering the first time.
Okay.
So it's really important to evaluate everything that we do, and that's something that I've been learning about.
Right.
Yeah.
And talking about measuring impact, I mean, obviously there's none better than talking to people who have been empowered by various projects, etc. And we're going to show a short YouTube video of young people that you've worked with.
Yes.
And what they said about it.
Yes.
Let's just watch that.
Okay.
It was like really fun exploring.
I thought it was the best experience of my life.
Yeah.
So you don't necessarily need to rock your pot.
It looks like a green dragon with white and black scales. Oh, it's so hot. I like how this bit gets darker here as well. It just looks like that bit's got a little shadow portrayed.
So tell us a bit about your artwork that you've done today. Hold them up for the camera so we can really.
I've done like a little, like the master of like these two.
Yeah.
They're just growing these ones out, and then like there's like the real one in the middle.
Okay. And how did you achieve this effect?
Did
you do it all in one go?
No, I did it in like separate pieces.
Right, so you did it in layers? Yeah?
Yeah.
Okay, and do you do art at school?
Yeah.
Do
yeah,
you like art at school?
Yeah.
Yeah, but we don't do anything like this at all.
Nothing.
Would you like art more at school if you did more stuff like this?
Definitely. I don't really like art at school.
You don't like it?
This is definitely better, 10 times.
Yeah.
So would you consider now that you've done this, taking art as a GCSE?
Yes,
yes.
And before doing this, would you have considered it?
No.
Well, I didn't really knew, like, I knew, like, art was like this, but I didn't know art was like this, and I didn't know it, like, came to this extent, so I thought I was doing it.
Yeah.
So So seeing that, obviously, you see someone saying, wow, this is the best thing I've ever done in my life. What does that make you feel?
God, that's amazing. I mean, if one, you know, I get lots of people saying that. So it really makes, it makes my heart so full. It's an amazing thing for that to happen.
Yes, and these are young people. They're not, you know, being polite or...
No, they will definitely say what they mean, you know, and young people are our future. So we need to look after them.
And it's not just women's right, and it's just not just young people, but you've also been involved with some ecological project, is that right?
Yes, I've worked with the Brighthelm Community Centre
here in Brighton,
and they created this beautiful, they work tirelessly, the gardening group there, and they work with creating a beautiful natural space in the city centre. And they had this beautiful butterfly garden that they'd created, and I noticed that a lot of people were just literally walking all over it and hadn't realised it was there.
Nice.
So I was actually commissioned by a local property management agent called Stiles Harold Williams to create a big artwork on the side. And I thought, well, what would be better than highlighting the fact that we've got bees and butterflies that are coming to the garden? So I sort of drew 6-foot-tall bees and
wow.
things like this. So people can actually really see that now. And it's all really flourishing. So that was lovely.
Right. I also noticed that you say, and you said it a couple of times, that the power of it all is that really it's ordinary people who are at the forefront of the social change, of
yes.
perhaps even social revolution. I mean, this is very apt for this particular series because this is all about extraordinary people. And we do believe that there aren't any ordinary people. I mean, it is all of us who are ordinary people who can
yeah.
actually make some extraordinary changes.
That's
and
right.
I think you're definitely one of these people.
No, thank you.
So thank you very much for coming today.
You're very welcome.
And
thank
good
you.
Luck with your continued work.
Thank you, Yael.
Goodbye.